Mr. Rivera.
Hey.
How's it going? You're on Shooting on the Ropes. What's going on, man?
Oh, shoot. This is Cubert Shaw Sisk.
Yes.
Oh, yeah, yo, how you doing today?
Good.
That's good. We're on the air. Are we allowed to cuss? That's the first thing I want to know.
You can say whatever you want to say, man.
Okay, what's happening? Let's just get right into it. The World of Wrestling. You called. You're talking to the president of the PWAS. That's right, the human amplifier, Steve Rivera. I'm fired up. We're here on Shooting the Ropes live with my man, Cuba. Call him what you want. We're here. What's happening, Daddy-O? Let's talk to wrestling.
Are you drunk?
I'm ready. I'm fired up, baby. I'm fired up all day. First time in a long time. Steve Rivera on the human amplifier shoot interview. I'm ready, baby. I'm ready to talk wrestling. Guys, what do you want to talk about? WWE, PWS, indie wrestling, you name it. We got it, baby. We're on tonight. We're on fire tonight. I'm fire right here. I'm shooting ropes, baby.
Well, you tell me where you want to start, because I obviously you've got a bunch of stuff you want to talk about, and of course we got your PWAS show going on this Friday.
Let's get right into that. This Friday night, Pro Wrestling All Stars, we return to our home venue, the Play Atlantis in Melvindale, Michigan. For those that aren't familiar with where Melvindale is, let me tell you, Cubert. Melvindale is on the borderline of Dearborn, Allen Park, Southwest Detroit, River Rouge. The Melvindale is right smack dab in the middle of, like, you know, right downriver, the heart, you know, right downriver, right just south of Detroit. The first city you come to is Melvindale, Michigan. And right now, the PWAS, we've been there for about 14 months, and we're changing the culture of independent wrestling. You know, we're pumping out some good shows, you know, contributing to that Detroit wrestling harder, that philosophy. You know, I mean, indie wrestling, you know, I've been everywhere. I've been all over the Midwest. Every time I go out of town, guys say, hey, Steve Rivera, we want to get down with coming to Detroit. We want to wrestle for Pro Wrestling All-Stars. And I tell them, guys, I say, you know what, bud? It's like this. Pro Wrestling All-Stars is like that hot chick you always wanted to bang in high school. You either come hard or you don't come at all. That's the motto of Detroit wrestling around here. It's Detroit versus everybody.
It's true.
And that's exactly how I feel. I have my guard up ready to go anytime, anywhere, any place. Let's talk about it, Daddy-O.
Speaking of people that want to be in your promotion, I saw that you have this 7-foot giant.
The giant Cucamonga. This Friday show. Doors open at 7:00. Show starts at 7:30. All tickets are affordable. $5 for kids, $10 for adults. That's what we do. We put affordable wrestling, good quality affordable wrestling. You're not gonna find no better wrestling south of 8 Mile and better than Pro Wrestling All Stars. And Friday we have our annual Wrestle Gold Gauntlet match. It's 12 men. 12 because it's the fan. The fans are important here. They are the 12th man, and that's why we're having a 12-man gauntlet match on Friday night, with the winner getting a shot at the Pro Wrestling All-Stars heavyweight title at our next event on Friday night, February 20th, back at the Play Atlantis. We got 3 championships on the line. You got Chase Matthews, the cold man from cold water, who's taking on one of the most talked about wrestlers in the area right now. I'm talking about the one Owen Travers. They're tangling up for the Cruiser Corps title. They've had a long storyline feud for the last several months. It all comes down to the last man standing for the Cruiser Corps title this Friday night. Well, the newly crowned Pro Wrestling All-Star Tag Team Champions, my former compadre, The Threat, Nate Manson and Briar Wellington, they take on the team, former PWAS Tag Team Champions, the first ever Pro Wrestling All-Star Tag Team Champions. I'm talking about Atlas Hightower, the natural Lance Star, the High Stars. If you watch history, last summer, it was the High Stars that defeated the Threat in the first round of the tag team tournament and went on to win, become the first ever PWAS tag team champion. They lost the belt a few months back. Now the Threat has the championship belt, and this Friday night, will history repeat itself with a high star going victorious on the Threat, or will the Threat come back and defeat the team that they couldn't beat at one time before? Plus, the Pro Wrestling All-Stars Heavyweight Championship. Officer Ron Street. He won the title last January 2014 at Russell Bowl event. He's the longest reigning PWAS heavyweight champion. He put the title on the line against one of the most ruthless individuals in not just Michigan indie or Detroit indie. I'm talking about the world of independent wrestling. I'm talking about the Necro Butcher and the Star of the Wrestler. You got the Necro Butcher taking on Rod Strang in a rematch from 3 weeks ago at New Year's Slammer. But this time, the SWAT team members will all be handcuffed to each ring post at ringside. Plus, we have the special attraction, put a little hand,
that's special.
In parentheses, is the giant Cucamonga makes his Michigan debut. Over 7 foot tall. This guy is huge.
Now, are you saying, I didn't mean to cut you off. Are you saying it's his Michigan debut, or it's his wrestling debut, or it's his public?
He's actually wrestled for about 15 years. On and off, on and off. I don't really know.
Where? Where the hell did this freak start wrestling at? That's what I'd like to know.
Where the freaks at wrestling?
No. I know where the freaks are at, and they're backstage. No, what I'm asking is where this freak came about 15 years ago is what I want to know.
Oh, I don't know, hiding somewhere.
Wait a minute, Steve. You found him. You found him and you're putting him on your show. You found him and you're putting him on your show, and you say you don't know where he came from. Come on.
He came from, I don't know. Storyline, I don't know where he came from. But he's from the suburbs, Duck Lake, Ohio. It's over by Cleveland. He's a big, tall. He's a huge man. He's got these huge, big hands. Yeah, he looks just like, wow. This guy, he's enormous. He's coming to Pro Wrestling All-Stars this Friday. We're going to see if the giant Cucamonga has what it takes to hang in the D when he makes his debut as a PWAF. Plus, the 12-man Russell Bull Gauntlet match. We have a barn burner event this Friday night in Melvindale, Michigan. Pro Wrestling All-Stars. You know, we're on fire right now, baby.
I think he's blown up.
Huber, I'm in the house. I'm fired up, man.
I think you blew up like 3 minutes ago.
But everything is good with the PWAS. Indie scene, it's like, I'm proud. I mean, we had a real good year in 2014. I personally had a great year. Everything I've encountered, I've wrestled I probably wrestled 5 matches throughout the whole year of 2014, but I still had my best year. Just everything I'm doing behind the scenes, I took some time off the wrestling so I could focus on the product. That's what's important at the end of the day. The fans' voice is louder than ever before in 2014. And in 2015, we're going to make them crave and want more. And that's exactly what it is.
Mm-hmm. Now, speaking that you took some time back and you were focusing on the product. My question is what did you see was wrong with the product before, and what's improved?
I'm not saying there was nothing wrong.
I'm not saying anything was wrong, but obviously you wanted to improve the product. Is it just bringing in new talent, bringing in better talent, getting rid of some talent that doesn't
need to
be around? That's what I'm asking.
I want to focus. I have a focus. And if I'm calling a match, I like to talk. But if I'm calling a wrestling match, I want to talk. I mean, for about an hour, I want to talk, and I want to give it everything I got.
Mm-hmm.
But running the show and making sure the whole overall program, I can go call a match and call for 5 to 10 minutes and, go out there and have a match. Yeah, old school, yeah. That's fine and dandy. But, I think the people deserve more. They want it more. I would like to wrestle, put more emphasis on my matches, what I do. But when I'm promoting shows at the PWAS and Play Atlanta, I think my focus is for the fans and giving them an overall experience and enjoying the wrestling product that we put out there.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And being the front man of the wrestling promotion, I think in 2014, I kind of like to focus more on the product and overall, as opposed to, okay, I got to get myself over. It's the youth movement. There's a youth movement in professional wrestling, and I feel like I'm one of the most instrumental wrestling promoters behind that, changing of the guard, if you will.
Okay.
Now,
speaking of the youth, of the young guys that you've had in your promotion, who would you say would be the guy to look to watch in 2015?
2015, oh man, that was tough. I think the natural Lance Starr, everything he's had a ups and downs year in 2014, and I think he's still hanging in there. He's going upstream. I think Chase Matthews, the current PWAS Cruiserweight Champion, he won that title back in August 8, 2014 at the Race to the Top. And he's been on fire. He's been doing everything we can ask for. He's setting a standard in the Cruiserweight division. Him and I'm excited about that match this Friday. Yeah, Owen Travers and Chase Matthews, they're going to tear the roof off once again to play Atlantis. That's going to be good. The Officer Rod Street, him and Jack Thriller, oh, what they got going on with the state of corruption, the inmates, the cop, you know, you got the social worker, FIA. It's just a mock of government politics, and it's like a wrestling storyline fascination. It's on fire, baby. Melvindale, Michigan, this Friday night, you got to be there or be square.
Obviously, you said that you're working more on the product of your company now. Obviously, there's a bunch of other promotions in the state of Michigan, and obviously, you want to try to showcase something different. You want to stand out. What do you think
we have to showcase something different? Okay.
Now, what do you think that what would be your point for your promotion? What makes you different than the other wrestling promotions?
Well, I mean, if everyone's using the same amount of guys, what's the difference? Just a couple letters? Promotion use all the same guys? Come on, let's form some solidarity, you know, some pride of our independence, so to speak. You know, I feel that we have some guys that work other promotions here, but not everybody does. That's the difference between us. You know, you're going to come out to a Pro Wrestling All-Stars, to an affordable price, $10 for adults, $5 for kids at the door. That's the only way we do tickets is at the door. I don't want to be bothered with pre-sale ticket money, but I want everybody to come to the door, single file line, no shoving, no pushing, grab the money, open the show, bam, figure it out. That's how we do. We figure things out in PWAS, and it's happening. It's a good thing right now. We're on fire.
Mm-hmm.
Now,
of course, like you said, you've been around for a while. For some of the people that may not be aware who you are, because I'm only saying that because this show obviously is broadcast throughout the world, so it's not just a local thing here in Michigan. For the people that are listening in different states, why don't you tell some people exactly, kind of give us like a quick highlight of your career and how you got started into the business.
Okay, I started training in November 1995 under Kangaroo Denny Cass at Club Canada, Hamilton, Ontario, Canada. Alongside me was my BFF, Briar Wellington, the King of Status, and then Tom Pierre Genchi, Pierre Olette, even Rhino. He was already training then. He was already like a year in. He was in his rookie year, and he could go on the car ride too with us. And then Denny Cass would take us out. We used to leave Detroit around 3 o'clock. Get out to Hamilton about 4 o'clock, 7 o'clock, 8 o'clock. We'd work out for about 4 hours, and then we'd come right back home. And we did this every month for about every Friday for about 6 months. And I started late at Club Canada. So, but Briar and Pierre, they started like with the number one session. I started towards the middle. So after that, Club Canada, Denny's deal was done. We came down, and then we started training a few months later. There was a brief stint. And then in 1996, the summer of 1996, we started training at the Motor City Athletic Club, ran by the great Malcolm Monroe Sr. And then at that time, Malcolm Jr. was training, too. There was a couple other guys. There was a big, jacked up, pumped up bodybuilder named Iron Dog. He was wrestling. He made it to training, and he wrestled for about a year or so. Didn't really pan out. He was just too big, just too much juice, too much juice carrying around. And then, but then after Motor City Athletic Club was only open for that summer, probably about 5 months in 1996, still I wasn't ring ready though. And then Denny Cass had some because ICW was running out of that the Great Lake or the Athletic Center on Lasher and Grand River there. Afterwards, Denny Cass, because Hector Hatchett was good with ICW then, I finished my training at Psychopathic Records over the winter of the 96-97 winter that time. And that's when I met Bubba McKenzie and then Mark Johansson, a.k.a. Referee Dirty Dan. And Denny was training them too. And then I had my first match in January 97. And before it was JCW. It was NAW, and they used to run private, like, Psychopathic Warehouse shows, and that's where I had my debut match. And I've been, ever since then, just been, I guess it's a sickness, this wrestling business, but that's what I've been doing, and here I am, fast forward almost 20 years later.
Mm-hmm.
Yep, still doing what I love and trying to set the tone for the next generation of wrestlers to come.
Yeah. Now, of course, you know, The one question that I've asked a lot of the guys that have been on here, when they went from the wrestling ring as a wrestler, then they opened up their own wrestling promotion. What would you say is not really the reason, but one of the feelings that you had that you wanted to make your own wrestling promotion and not really just go against these other promotions, but obviously, like you said, you wanted to be different than all the other promotions. But what brought you to the point that
opening PWAS? What made me want to step up out of the fray and, yeah, you know, be a leader instead of a follower?
Yeah.
I don't know. I mean, it's real political, real shady around it. Was. I mean, you know, I tried not to be like, you know, so political or, oh, it's, you know. And I think the art of entertainment and the creative side, you know, I had nothing else to do, you know. I mean, here I am. I just congratulate. I'm in high school. What do you want to be when you get out of high school? I want to be a wrestler. Damn set, I'm going to do it. And I did it. Now, you know, but I don't know. Just the art of entertainment. You know, just everybody. I just the locker room and, you know, not getting rich off of it. But, I mean, I love doing this for the future of tomorrow. I love being a part of it. Even if I'm getting old and gray and hair's falling out and my body's beat up, I still love wrestling.
Mm-hmm.
So try to preserve myself the next few years. Just, you know, just go for it. You know, put it out. I figure it out. That's what I'm all about.
Mm-hmm. Now,
you know that by now.
Yeah. Now we've me and you've had discussions a couple times concerning the fans and the attendance in wrestling shows here in the state of Michigan compared to the East Coast. What do you think would be the obviously there's a big difference. What would you say is the difference that of the East Coast and the Midwest, and what the Midwest needs to take from the East to bring that popularity and that to bring those type of fans, those amount of fans.
Well, East Coast, it's real. I mean, there's more people out on the East Coast, the most populated part of the United States. And then, you know, I mean, they're tougher critics. And they tougher critics, you have to convince your audience. Some guys, I mean, just, like I said, like, you see guys, it's one promotion, they're against each other, and then across town, 30 minutes away, they're with each other. It just doesn't make sense, you know? I mean, they can look like that shooting, cutting-edge style. That's what made wrestling. I remember in 1995, I went to one of the great MCW shows of yesteryears. And I remember, like, the wrestling, Bruiser Bedlam used to come out there, and he's a legitimate badass, and he's probably one of the baddest wrestlers that ever wrestled in Indies, Michigan, still to this date. And Bruiser Bedlam, he's a legitimate badass, okay? And he made the wrestling look real. And we were like so real. The punches were stiff. I mean, and the fans, back then I remember being an audience, and like his velocity and his intensity, you know, and his like cutting edge style of wrestling, it brought out to the fans. And the fans, yeah, they're all marks. Some of them were morons, but they were dysfunctional morons that loved it. It's like crazy dysfunctional wrestling fans and Taylor Tucky, you know, and they're getting all pumped up. Yeah, yeah. Half retarded people with crooked eyes, you know, slobbering all over themselves. But that's what made wrestling real. It was like that cutting edge style. We need more of that cutting edge style today to make wrestling, make the fans believe it's real. That's what it's all about. If the people believe it's real, they're coming back and buying it more. And that's the difference. That's what I think needs to happen to that. I think it needs to be more cutting edge, more work shoots, more stiff stuff, you know?
So
it's just the style. The style has changed. And I believe it has changed in the last year or so, and I expect more change in the next year or two.
Because I was going to say, in a way, it's almost like everyone, I'm not saying the wrestlers, but for some reason, to you, it kind of seems that everyone's kind of taking a step back, and they're behind in the times, kind of compared to the East Coast. Is that kind of sound about right?
No, I just think the East Coast, you're gonna see that ultra violent style. You know, the fans, they know like the work, the shoot, the baby, the thing. It's even in their slang. It's more than that, you know. I went out about a year ago. I went out to the East Coast for the CZW Cage Draft. They had a show, 1,500 people. Right? Ring of Honor was like an hour and 20 minutes away. We were there in the Manhattan Center. They had over 1,000 people. Then there was another one, PWAS. And then they had two shows, a man show earlier in the day, like a student show. And then they had a female show at night, and they had 400. All those numbers, that's like nearly 3,000 fans within an hour and a half of each other. What the hell? 3,000 wrestling fans, man. I mean, shoot, that's a lot. That's a lot in one area, you know, because they believe it. The wrestling fans believe the product is real. And that's what these young guys, that's what they got to do. They got to step up and grab the brass ring, so to speak. Step up and grow a set of balls. Balls to the wall. Figure it out. That's going to get you noticed.
Yeah. Now tell me if this is true or not. Does it seem more like... Because I don't know how they do really all the advertising out there in the East Coast either. But it seems that everyone does most of their promoting for their shows using social media, like Twitter and your Facebooks and Instagrams and whatnot.
Right.
Do you think that, because no one really does it the old school way, going to shows with the flyers and whatnot, that it kind of killed the fan base?
I mean, it's good. We didn't have that technology back 15 years ago, 20 years ago, even like 5 years ago. It wasn't like the way it is now.
And that
has changed. I mean, back then it's like guys used to bust their ass, go town to town, try to send tapes out to promoters. Now they just click on a link. Here's my YouTube. Check me out. Everything's like all in your, you know, in your palm, power in your palm, in your hand. Cell phones today, and that technology does have everything. It does have things to do with it, you know. Word gets out quicker, it's better. I mean, social media can make a show, but it also can break the show if you don't do the necessary elements that you need to do to have a successful wrestling show. You got to do the legwork, you got to do the grunt work. That's part of promoting, that's part of it, you know. You have to, I could put out like 100,000 flyers. And I can get 15 people on my show, you know, if I don't put those 100,000 flyers out where people are going to see them, you know.
Exactly.
So it's all the businesses. I mean, you got to have wrestlers worth the shit that fucking more people want to see, you know. I have guys that always ask me, hey, Steve, how do we get Rivera? How do we get, you know, Pro Wrestling All-Stars? We want guys that wrestle every weekend. That's our science behind it. We get guys that wrestle every weekend, so we don't get the once a month or Johnny come lately. Mm-hmm. It's a new culture. Yeah, people want to follow their favorite wrestler. They want to know, hey, wrestling fans want to know, run Jack Rome. Where's Jack Thriller? Oh, he's wrestling in Indiana. He's in Goshen, Indiana. Oh, he's in Nashville, Michigan. He's in Detroit, Michigan. He's doing it up. People want to follow their favorite wrestler. That's how it is. It's becoming that way.
Now, you were talking about how everyone basically passes around tapes and used to pass around tapes and everyone sends the links to YouTube and stuff like that. Do you think that, and you were saying too that you're looking for guys that, you know, work every weekend, not someone that's generally come lately and, mm-hmm. you know, obviously we always hear that the term the 40 miler, you know.
40 miler, very popular. 40,
yes, yes. Now, how do you, obviously you've been around, so you know a lot of the people and you know exactly kind of what's going on, especially in this area. If you have somebody that kind of pops up out of nowhere and passes you some information that says, you know, hey, I've been training here wrestling and whatnot, but they have no, they really have no background. You know, I'm basically pointing to the backyarders, the yarders that try to, you know, say, oh, so-and-so trained me and yada, yada. How much actually background work do you kind of do on some of the guys that just kind of come out of nowhere?
You know, what you just said, I've learned a very important lesson on that within the last couple of years. I'm glad you brought that up.
Oh, you knew I was going to bring it up. Come on, man.
Even one of my best friends, Briar Wellington, BFM, everybody uses his name to get the, hey, Briar Wellington, and meanwhile, the boys are like, oh, that Briar Wellington, they're kind of mad, like, why did Briar do this, and meanwhile, Briar's like, counting the money, yeah, I trained him, he got his cardio, and he's making money, he don't care, you know, but I talked with him about that, and I said, hey, you know, a lot of people have been asking me, oh, you want to put your foot forward, help make a wrestling facility. And I talked with them about a few guys myself. And when the right time comes, we will have a wrestling school facility, but I will have one in place with the right proper trainers.
So Luke Crank ain't gonna be your trainer, huh? Damn.
Luke Cranky, I mean, if it was at Gold's Gym or Powerhouse Gym, he could train. That guy's fast. But anywhere else, I mean, you know, I think we need to talk last.
Missile drop kick.
Fast, you know?
Yep.
That guy can pull. I mean, I went to the gym once before with Luke Crank, and just doing dumbbell push-ups, man. Just dumbbells like flies, man. That guy was doing almost double my amount of weight, and I was about to puke. I'm like, oh my God, that little shrinky dude, you guys on fire.
Well, you know what? He ain't got much to do concerning you. Well, actually, before he was signed with a company that only ran about once every two of the three quarters, so.
Right, so.
You know, so there's nothing else for you to do anyways.
Controversial comments, yeah. You're a very controversial character yourself, Mr. Sisk.
It's not controversial. It's more of I'm very open. I don't
very
hold back.
Open.
You know, I mean, I'm not the
very,
I'm not, you know
open.
What though? I'm not the only one. You do too though. I'm not the only one. You do too though. You've caused some problems
stripes.
Too, so.
I heard my stripes. There ain't no 40 miler here, buddy. I can crack every vertebrae from my ass to my brain, buddy. So I think I'd have to like to say something, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So, but yeah. You said something the other night that like pertained to me and it's been on my mind.
Huh?
About Randy West.
Okay.
And then like I kind of like took it like, why did he say something about Randy?
Well, here's the thing. Here's the thing. Okay. All right. I knew you were gonna bring this up, so you know what? Whatever. Don't really give. I really don't give a flying fuck. You know what? Because, To me, what's funny is that the comment was made in a Facebook forum. Okay, I didn't exactly name, but of course everyone decided to pick that's who I was talking about. All right, what's funny is that the person that actually sent the information to the one that made the big boast about it online is someone that was sitting there and would bitch and moan and make all the comments they were about this wrestling promoter. Yet, all of a sudden, next thing I know, they're gone from your promotion, and now they're kissing somebody else's ass. And now yeah, all of a sudden they're everyone's all you know kissing ass over there, and now we got this whole word sheet thing going.
Figured out. I don't know, but I'm just saying, Randy West.
I will admit this.
Bleeding. I seen her get her wig split, her fucking forehead dome split by her ex old man Clunk the Clown at the Majestic Theater during a Bumpin' Uglies concert. And this was in Devil's Night 2004. And she got her head split. There was blood all over the floor. And everyone jumping wild and doing these wrestling spots during the Bumpin' Uglies Smash Pit concert performance. And then the next thing, you know, everybody's gone. Why? Because they're all, Randy's head got split open, blood all over. And I'm talking like, I've got like a 15 by 15 square area of the Majestic Lords and filled with like blood stains and blood of puddles all over it. And then all I do is we had to stop what we were doing. Got to go to the hospital two blocks over. And I came back, the Bumpin' Uglies still playing. They're like, where did everybody go? And I was laughing so hard my ribs were hurting that night. But, oh my God. But Randy, she's one tough fucking. She's one tough bitch, I'll tell you, you know, despite, you know, whatever, you know, I'm not going to get into people's personal lives too much, but she's one tough chick. And that Queen of the Deathmatch tournament, there was some fucking, there was some hard bitches in that tournament. I'm talking the Hudson Envy, Heidi Lovelace, you know, all the other girls that were there, man. And then for her to get put on that pedestal and to get that honor, that takes the respect thing. And it's the girls that also were part of that turn of the respect thing. And I think that she deserved that. So, but I just felt that way. Any other subjects? Let's talk.
I don't know. I mean, you tell me.
Hold on.
You tell me. Because, you know, you asked me something, and there's been. Since you want to put me on the spot, Steve, I'm gonna put you on the spot. All right.
We're gonna
go back and forth. See, this is how it works. But you know what? I'm game. You're game. Let's play this game. All right. No hard feelings on this. You've walked past it, so we're gonna bring this up. You've been a very vocal person online.
I don't try to be, but people grab me by the balls and drag my ass across the floor and try to get some attention out of it, because everybody wants to do the whole,
you know, work shooting stuff on the internet and think everything's going to work for them. So, you know what? Let's go with this. So, of course, there's been numerous times that you've been online, you've kind of butted in that, you know, someone will make a comment, and you've obviously been vocal. I know you love your promotion, you love what you're doing, you love the product that you're doing, the quality.
I love the business, period. Yeah. Maybe I bumped too many times in my head, but I, like, thinking deranged, I love the business. You know, I don't do things for me, I do things for the business side, you know, I need to put promotion ahead of myself. That's how I've always been, and I have to still be there.
Yeah.
I'm not 167 times champion of my own promotion. I'm Steve Rivera, and I'm more the future. I'm focusing on the future, trying to get these guys, and, you know, if I want to be around another 10, 15 years, I got to do that, you know. Not going to be the Steve Rivera show every time, but go ahead, shoot.
You know, it's just, a lot of the times, some of the comments that you make, a lot of the people obviously have said, you know, that, you know, some of the comments you made have kind of been childish. I mean, a lot of times we kind of get over our heads sometimes when we get in, you know, arguments online and whatnot. You know, like I said, you know,
yeah.
I mean, you've earned, like you said earlier, you earned your stripes. Obviously, you know, I'm just a mark, you know, behind the microphone and behind, you know, and whatnot. So whatever, you know what? I frankly don't give a fuck.
Well, but you do good. I'll enjoy all your Michigan flashback footage, everything you post on there. I appreciate that. People like you in the business, I appreciate that. You have a lot of heart. You're not just a fly-by-night ring announcer from 14 years ago. You're not this. You're the man right now. You're the Michigan flashback. You brought the Michigan wrestling flashback. And I think that kind of was like, you kind of changed a lot of things. You know, you brought the realm flashback as a vocabulary word.
I honestly don't think I really did much of shit, but in a way, I I don't want to say I did, but it brought back a lot of memories for a lot of guys. And obviously, was it last year or so, we had the IWR reunion, which I thought was awesome.
Yes, that was good. Props to you. Props to all the guys behind that. That was a feather in the cap, so to speak.
That was
something that needed to be done, and there was a lot of people, you know, and it happened. It was good.
I mean, like you were saying, you know, and people have called me it, and, you know, like I said, I don't care. They've called me a mark or whatever. And, you know, like I said, I really don't care. You know, I've never really thought I was a part of the business regardless because, you know, all I did was do ring announcing and whatnot and acted as like a commissioner or whatever. But the difference is that unlike a lot of other wrestling fans, I actually give a damn about the business I wouldn't say not as much as you guys, because obviously you guys bust your ass, get into the ring, and get your, you know, get your dues. I've never done any of that. I've never sat there and tried making money off any of it either. But with a lot of the garbage that I've seen, obviously we got a bunch of backyard wrestlers, backyard promotions like John Campbell's IWE, and then we got the MWO out there. And, you know, and they're basically ruining the sport for you guys. The guys have been busting their ass, and it's taking away fans and asses out of the seats. That you guys have, like I said, busted your ass to get you as a promoter. You don't want a promotion that has all these guys that never been trained and look like complete jackasses representing your area and taking away your fans, correct?
Yes, you're right. I had that mentality before. Like, hey, you know, because I've been blackballed for years by guys around here in the politics. And that's what ate at me to a point where, hey, it wasn't about me. About the whole product, and that's what made fuel, put the fuel in me and got me motivated, helped make Pro Wrestling All-Stars what it is today. And I went to that growing pains, like I said, everybody burnt out Brother's name, but I wanted to give everybody the benefit of the doubt.
Mm-hmm.
You know, all these guys say, hey, I'm Brian Wellington students, and you know what? Yeah, like all those guys that did it, there are some of the guys that got weeded out that are hot on the wrestling scene today. Mm-hmm. I'm talking about Atlas Hightower. He's tall. Is he like 6'2"? He's 6'3". You know, tall, good-looking, young, blue chipper. The one, Owen Travers. Now, Owen Travers getting loved by Jimmy Jacobs, going down to Ring of Honor, doing all his little bookings, and, you know, doing everything else. You know, that's, you know, what he does. You know, and it's, you know, there's been a few other guys, too. You know, but that's what makes wrestling. And then there's other guys that are like, shit stained up the bed, and I was like, ah, we gave him chance, and, you know. Then there's, like, my own personal rib. You got, like, the Bullet Khan, like, Kamala fetish of mine. You got Bullet Khan, they got the BB Butcher, they got the Big Africa, and now, this Friday night, you're the Giant Cucamonga! Oh, boy, we're on fire here tonight, baby. Shoot the ropes. I'm fired up, Charles. We got to do this more often.
I don't know how you're gonna beat this 7-foot freak. Really?
Giant Cucamonga. You got an invitation this Friday night.
I'll tell you what.
Bring your kick on down. I'll make sure I go get the old school Polaroid camera. We'll get a big picture of the Giant Cucamonga. Put that on your website, your banner.
Yeah. Page, yeah. Put that big ass freaking thing. Yeah. I honestly hope that you have some type of insurance in case that dude, you know, goes to take a step and breaks, you know, half his body. Because that dude just does not look right at all. It looks like three Ethiopians melted together.
Oh, man, you got to be there Friday night. You never know what could happen. You never know what's going to happen. Pro wrestling all times, you know. Even our fans there, they can't topple aware. What on the wrestling show where the fans want a Tupperware was so on demand? Tupperware is over, dude. It's over.
Tupperware. Jesus Christ.
It's more over than a hip toss, baby. It's over, man. I'm telling you. We got a good thing in Melvindale. And if people out there, the listeners, have not heard, you guys have to check this out. We run each and every month, every 3 to 5 weeks at the Play Atlantis. The Play Atlantis is located at 19400 Allen Road in Melvindale, Michigan. Mm-hmm. And that's where we're at. You know, we'll be there Friday night, January 23rd. We'll be back there February 20th. We'll be after that. It'll be March 13th. Those are our next three dates there, and we have a good thing, and I want you guys, all the listeners out here, support Shoot the Ropes. Check us out. Add us on Facebook at Pro Wrestling All Stars of Detroit, and Twitter, PWAS Detroit. You know, find out more information about us. You know, we have a good thing going. Check out affordable wrestling, good wrestling. We got the Necro Butcher, Officer Rob Street. That dickhead crony police officer. That's gonna be good. He is over, man. The crowd is so receptive to him. They're like, boo, they can't snap. He's been a champion for one whole year.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the reign is 1 year since WrestleBowl last year. Officer Rob Street, he's a wrestler's wrestler, mind you.
Mm-hmm.
Him, Jack Thriller, Chase Matthews, Cole Water crew that comes out to PWAS. I love them guys, man. They can wrestle. They can wrestle with the best of them.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you talk about the best. I mean, that's just a monarchy. That's just an opinion. You know, because I tell you what, when on Friday nights in Melvindale, those guys, you can't ask for a locker room that works any harder.
Mm-hmm.
Like I say, you know, it's Detroit versus everybody, and they're like, you either come hard or you don't come at all.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and you know what though? That's the thing though. It should be that way instead of, I mean, to be honest, and I brought this up before, and I'll ask your opinion. Like we were talking about with a lot of the trained and untrained guys, and do you think that there would be as many wrestling promotions around, especially in the state of Michigan, if they had some type of union that, you know, of course, the promoter's got to have, you know, got to pay your dues and you got to pay so much. Do you think?
Well, I mean, a union, I mean, what are you going to do? A union, make 25, 40 bucks if you're lucky, you know? Yeah. I mean, they'll go off to work off the gate or guaranteed salary. It'll mm-hmm. include medical and 401k. It basically, if anything, if the state gets involved, it's gonna, you know, what's it gonna happen? There more insurances, they're gonna get their cut. It probably won't be, if the state did regulate professional wrestling on the Sports Athletic Commission, there probably wouldn't be any of these fly by night promotions. I'd give you that. But then I think it'll be harder, and, you know, I don't know, look at Windsor, look what they've done. Look mm-hmm. at, I mean, they have Border City Wrestling. Kudos to Scott DeMore, Tyson Dukes. They got a damn good show out there. I haven't been out there in a few years, but just by looking at the flyers and seeing the pictures and, you know, the response I hear from others that are there, I mean, they got a pretty damn good thing going over there, man, you know. They'll regulate mm-hmm. it. At least they were, like, you know, years ago.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you need a passport just to get across the damn bridge these days. Yeah. Yep. Figure that one out.
Yeah, I was going to say that, I mean, the one thing is that if they had some type of union, there'd be no more fun wrestling, it'd be real wrestling. So, you know, that's obviously the difference.
I think that too, but I also think it's like what the people get, you know, I mean, it's kind of like a hard subject to tell. I mean, just, you know, not everybody has like thousands and thousands of dollars to put in to run a wrestling show, but at the same time, you know, Rich Money Mark came to me, I'd be happy. I'd be like, figure it out, boy. Mm-hmm.
Now, the one thing that I've asked some people before is, obviously, it's location, location, location for wrestling.
Location, yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
You know, do you think that, obviously, there's been a lot for a while there. There was like, you had like three or four wrestling promotions running within like a 10, 15 mile radius. You know, everyone was so close at the same time.
I'm glad. A lot of these promotions slowed down running shows. You know, fucking Brian Shatwell, he couldn't figure it out. He worked all the boys. Like, you're going to be on TV. You're going to be on public access. He worked that gig for a year until no cable access. Next season, it ran flat. Yeah. You know, Johnny Badwheel, you don't know what the hell he's doing, dude. nothing bad about him, but he don't know what he's doing. They take advantage of that big little crippled man in a little wheelchair, go watch a hockey game or something. I don't know. They take advantage of him. Keith Calhoun, he's so fucking, him and that fucking pink Indian and that whatever, that fucking flamingo friends, those guys are freaking idiots, man. I've never, they think they're legit wrestlers and that their replica belts mean something. Come on, bro. Go to the flea market. Go to the flea market. I'll hawk that bitch for $25. Yeah, you know?
Yeah, I was gonna say you forgot good old Ed, but you know I think everyone I don't think you have to talk about him either.
I worked for Ed for years, all those years, like these promotions that I talk about, like blackballing and blacklisting. I had no choice, and I had to work with Ed. It was cool, AWWL, back in the day when he brought in guys like Kevin Sullivan, Rock and Roll Express, Cisco Inferno, Sabu, Monty Brown, Paul Mahoney, Crowbar, Devin Storm. He used to bring in like Cisco Inferno. He used to bring in a lot of guys, Big Cat, Mr. Hughes, that guy, you know. But then over a period of time, he stopped bringing them in, and you know, like he lost his money back, and he just stuck with the local Joko guys. Bunch of dumb idiots. I mean, you know, the Sheik's name, yes, it brings prestige, but also, if you're bringing, you know, I wouldn't say trash bag wrestling, glad bag wrestling, what do you expect? I mean, you know, but I worked for Ed for years, and I know firsthand, he is an idiot. He is a first-class idiot, you know? Mm-hmm. And maybe the Sheik's probably rolling over in his grave to see some of the shit Ed's done.
Well, 10, see,
12 years.
See, I said that, and I even had Dave Drazen on the show a couple months ago, and he even spoke about it. You know, just basically what he's doing, he's going to try to make a B-roll part two of the one movie he's
like
thinking about.
I like to hurt people, too. Yeah, he told me that years ago. Ed Farhan,
he's on his way to Kobo and all the other shit. He's still trying to find his way to Kobo.
He let me go because I decided to run my own promotion. Right? But you know what? I'm not going to argue with an idiot. You know, I'm rubber. You're glue. What you say bounces off me and back on you, you big dummy.
Yeah.
Figure it out.
Well, you know what he did too, obviously, and it's something that I don't know how everything works backstage. So, I mean, but he still kind of runs in the 80s, you know, with the whole you're going to work for me and you're not going to work for anybody else, sign this contract.
Yeah,
like he's, you know,
he's
Eric Bischoff.
I've never met a political stress. Like, I'm going to put my career in the palm of your hands, Ed, for fucking 30 hours a month. I'm going to go to Jackson, Michigan. When you tell everybody you have television all over the country, but you still only run in Jackson, Michigan.
Yeah.
It reminds me of that idiotic flyer. Hey, we're in Mount Pleasant, and we're going to be running TV in Manhattan, you big dummies. Then you run wrestling shows in Manhattan. The fuck, man. The East Coast fans, they want to see John Campbell, fake Canadian bullshit. Come on, man. Figure it out.
Yeah. Bringing that up, and that's a really shitty thing, is that That is basically representing the state of Michigan, and it is, you know,
it's so far up north.
Here's the thing, though. Okay, would I rather have Ed Jr.'s AWWL and the Sheik and Technicolor, or do I want to see John Campbell's guys that are dressed as crash test dummies and wear helmets and look like, you know, people from what is that? What was that TV show?
That 70s show?
Not that 70s show. The one with the oh my god. Life Goes On. There you go.
Corky. Okay.
Yeah, Corky, there you go.
Corky Warfare. That's like asking me,
enough.
How do you want to die? You want to get shot in your head with a 12-gauge caliber? Or you want to blown up in your tongue and engulfed in flames. That's comparing AWWL and IWE. I mean, what do you figure that one out? I don't know what to say. You know, and the only thing here that's any good is, you know, the vintage.
I've noticed a lot of the stuff that he has, it's supposed to, you know, that it's supposed to be family keepsake. If you ever type up the Sheik on eBay, you'll find a lot of it coming from his house. It's about as bad as the scam that was going on a couple months ago with another legend.
Oh, like Jessica on Craigslist, or that ad?
No, not that. No. I wasn't even going anywhere around that fat fuck. No, what I was talking about was the one of the other legends that passed away recently. That somebody, I guess, a homemaker or whatnot, was actually selling this stuff on eBay. I can't remember who it was, and the name completely blows away. It completely is out of my mind right now, so I can't even remember who it was.
Right.
But yeah, I mean that type of stuff, you know, obviously goes on. What else you want to talk about? I mean, you know.
The WWE Raw. I mean, last night I watched Raw. I caught the last 20 minutes of it. And I'll tell you, there was a good 20 minutes of WWE television. I got to see Brock Lesnar. I got to see Sting. I got to see Seth Rollins. That was a good finish. That was a Triple H. That was a good, the last 15 minutes of it, that was compelling TV. I thought that was really wrote out well.
Mm-hmm.
That's awesome. Brock Lesnar, he's the baddest motherfucker in the wrestling today.
Well, see,
the baddest. He sleep figured out repeats. I live by that guy's standards.
Mm-hmm. We'll see the.
I might not be able to conquer, but I'll figure it out one way or the other. Mm-hmm.
Well, see, the thing is with the WWE, usually when they right before they have a pay per view, they totally bomb on TV, and like you said. Obviously, they actually prevailed this time for the first time in months since, I think, Survivor Series. So.
Oh, yeah, that was a good TV. I mean, I only caught that last 20 minutes, and then it was a good 20 minutes, though, I tell you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it was
very compelling TV, wrote up. Well, I was happy, you know. I think indie scene, I mean, I like to see the guys in indie scene step it up, too, man. I mean, there's a lot of things happening, and I'm hoping, I mean, 2014, I got to work alongside the Nature Boy, Ric Flair. Woo! Last August. That was an experience. That was an experience of a lifetime, I'll tell you what. You asked Nature Boy about the security guy that promotes wrestling shows in Detroit. Oh, yeah, they're like, woo, not that guy. I tell you, man, it was fun. It was fun there. I like, when I did that thing in August for Big League Drews, we had Michael Grant, Atlas Hightower there, and Stephen Hall, security guy. I even had the Aztec Warrior working with me, doing security spots. And Ric Flair was really cool. Ric Flair was like a real cool. Rowdy, I got to see Mike Antoine McMahon, him cracking up jokes at the people. Like, look, that's Rowdy, Wally, Wyatt. And then big guy with a kilt on and a beard. It was great. I got to talk to Ric Flair. Really, who knows? Maybe you'll see him in Pro Wrestling All-Stars one day. You never know.
Well, I mean, well, you know what? If you tell him that you'll help pay his alimony, I think he'll work anywhere, so.
Yeah. He's a very cool guy. I got to, you know, real cool experience for myself. Get to see the giant Cucamonga this Friday night. It's going to be great, dude. Pro Wrestling All-Stars, you know, where wrestling matters. That's exactly what we're trying to do.
It matters, but you got a 7-foot freak. I don't know how that matters.
We'll see what happens Friday, you know.
Like I said, it looks like three Ethiopians, man, put together.
Yeah.
You know, they're struggling for that one piece of rice, man. I don't know.
And then what else is happening in the world of professional wrestling? There's a lot of good 2014. A lot of good times, you know. I thought it was a good definitive year in wrestling.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You want to talk about wrestling, you know. I'll tell you one subject that, like, you know, might, trickle some people's feelings. You know, you guys need to step it up. Because when a drunken photographer can go on Facebook and he can get more heat than some of these guys, you know what I'm talking about. When he can go on, I see a drunken photographer go on Facebook and he can rile up fans more than the wrestlers. Come on, man. I want to bring it hard. Don't let the photographer shoot you down.
Yeah. I'll give you that one.
Jake Sutt. Well, shout out to Jake Sutt right there.
I'll give you that one. I'll give you that one.
Okay.
You know what? You know what's funny? You know what's funny? It took 53 minutes for his name to get brought up. That's amazing. I figured that would have been the first 10 minutes.
Oh, that's because I just got the text message.
Oh, okay. All right. I got you. Okay.
Dude,
See, you forgot about him, didn't you? Someone had to send you a text to remember. Okay, that's a weird one.
Back to indie wrestling. I mean, I'm not to say pro wrestling all stars. I mean, in indie wrestling, period. I mean, it's changed. I mean, just look on television today.
Mm-hmm.
Wrestling is back at its peak.
Yep.
I don't think it has been back since like the year 2000, 2001, right before Vince bought WCW. You know, you have wrestling. It's on like pretty much every night of the week.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, for Monday Night Raw. Yeah, Tuesday, I don't even know what happened. You got the main event, you got NXT, you got the Lucha Underground, you got the New Japan Wrestling, they just start showing on Friday nights, you got TNA on Friday nights, even a stupid reality, whatever, work with the wrestling with death.
Yeah, that show kills me, boy. That's on right now, I think, isn't it?
Yeah, probably Tuesday. Something's got to be on.
Then you got Total Divas on Sundays.
Wrestling is strong right now.
Mm-hmm.
Wrestling is strong. It's because, you know, the guys at the bottom are working their way to the top. And, you know, that's how it is. If everyone just doing what they're doing, you know.
Yeah,
I like to see breakout stars break out of Michigan. I like to see the next Chris Sabin or Alex Shelley come out. You know, I like to see the next Monty Brown, you know, give somebody a big, you know.
Well, I mean, the bad thing is when you got people promoting their companies that wrestlers that don't belong on TV, it's not going to help this area, obviously, because they're going to look at that and see that's a joke.
But yeah. I think because the unknown wrestling society, and then, you know what I'm talking about, I think that made a stronger presence in the state of Michigan. Mm-hmm. I think when you have a group of people a part of the unknown wrestling asylum, everybody wants to step up. Everyone will identify, hey, what the wrong is and what the mm-hmm. right is, and it makes a better environment overall.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I think that's probably why the game has changed. You know, the unknown wrestling asylum is, kind of smart me, you know. Like, you know, we just got Pro Wrestling All-Stars in December 2013. We ran 14 shows there, 15 shows this Friday. The unknown wrestling asylum is what changed it. That's why you don't see Flex Armstrong anymore in Pro Wrestling All-Stars. The unknown wrestling asylum is changed the culture of wrestling. Shout out to Joe Ranta on that one. Joe Ranta Rave. That's not a Craigslist ad, buddy. Don't go looking for Jessica on top of that one.
No, oh, Christ.
No.
Uh-huh. No. Everything other than that, you know.
Yeah.
I'm hoping that 2015 brings more of the same of last year, but even better. You mm-hmm. know, we already got one show down. We're ready to do it. Not just us. I'm talking about the other promotions across town. SICW, I know they did a good show the other night. I haven't been to their shows in years, but I just know on paper and flyers that they're doing strong things. And Johnny Delicious, shout out to him. I know he turned it around over there, too. They had a good group of people working together to put that product together.
Mm-hmm.
You know? And same thing with the guy up north. But then, the UCW, is that the one it is? The UWA? There's so many of them all up north.
UCW up in Bay City.
Yeah, the one that's had a hacksaw.
Yep.
And Eugene coming on February 20th. They had Chris Sabin. Nate Bats helped them out, structure their life a little too. He's helped us out too. They're going to be good. They're good for up north. I think they're really good for up north.
They're a lot better
than that fucking Alcatraz cast promotion, you know?
Selling cars in between intermissions. Yeah, I mean, you know that the UCW. I'll tell you what. When I went to their show, when was that? November, October? I'm trying to remember when their last show was.
Yes, I remember that. I remember that.
But there, I'll tell you what. That venue, it was a great venue. Especially the way the atmosphere was. I mean, one thing is they got like a bar on every other part of the level. But I mean, just the atmosphere and the acoustics was just awesome, especially when they had the way they had stuff displayed on the walls and whatnot. It's not just the fans, and it's not really just the quality of wrestling, but it's the type of atmosphere that where you have your show at. I think a lot part of it has to be
atmosphere
as well.
It has a feel of being in an arena, like as you know, I know you're saying, presentation of your mm-hmm. show and the surrounding, the location, we were mm-hmm. talking about earlier. Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
I believe that.
Yeah, and it's not just that, but I mean, as long as you present yourself to look like you're a professional company, they'll take you as you know, a real company. But when you've got people coming out,
we all work together with the Unknown Wrestling Asylum. Then, you know, the bad will get weeded out.
Jesus.
You know, that's how, I don't know what else to say. I mean, I'm happy. I love wrestling. Right now wrestling's at an all-time high. I'm loving it. I'm feeling it right now.
Mm-hmm. I don't know what else, man. You've been bouncing off the walls more than a maniac in a freaking convention. So I don't know, man.
We'll see. I mean, this Friday night, Cuber. You want to come on down? You're more than welcome to come check out the product, see what we have in store. Although Chuck Wagon, I haven't been to their shows, the Apex shows, but I hear a lot. I hear good things. I hear they have a nice venue, and then they have a couple good solid shows. I wish them luck too. I hope that they do. I hope they do good on the north side of M-59. I'll keep worrying about South 8 Mile, or at least south of South Detroit. so we'll see. Southwest Detroit, Cinco de Mayo. I'm waiting for Cinco de Mayo. We're going to be back there at Southwest Detroit. Cinco de Mayo. That's going to be a good show. We got a lot of good shows happening this summer.
You're going to bring the masked superstar back for that show? The one that doesn't watch the masked superstar that says that if you're a wrestler, you don't watch Monday night or Thursday nights or
Okay, I don't know. That's from that Kid Wexler, Brian Shatwell show. And I don't know the Masked Superstar. But I do know I know that for us, we're going to do all our shows in Melbourne. We got our Cinco de Mayo, our annual Cinco de Mayo show in Southwest Detroit.
In case you forgot who the Masked Superstar is, he'll build you a house and he'll cut the lawn afterwards. So, that guy. You don't remember who this, then,
El Toro.
Oh, boy.
We're having it right here. Our sweet girls, ladies and gentlemen. John Fisk, it's been a pleasure. It's been a pleasure being on here. Anytime you want to talk, But look how ridiculous, pal. Oh, my God. We'll have one. We'll figure it out, So, yeah, we will figure it out. But hey, it's been great. I'm going to have to wrap it up here.
All right.
I appreciate time with you. Listen. And then hopefully we can do this again maybe next month sometime. But whatever, you let me know. We'll figure it out. Call me. Let me know. Inbox it.
All right. I'll let you know, man. All right. Appreciate it.
All right. Have a good one. All right, listeners. TWS, one more time. TWS this Friday night, January 23rd, from the Play Atlantic in Melvindale, Michigan. You got Pro Wrestling All-Stars presents Wrestle Bowl 2015, the 12-man gauntlet for a shot at the Pro Wrestling All-Stars Heavyweight Championship on February 20th. And then we have three big title matches. The PWAS Tag Team Championships on the line. It's a threat. Briar Wellington and Nate Bassett take on the High Stars. Atlas Hightower and the National Lamb Stars. Then, our last man standing match for the Cruiser Core title. We have the current champion, Jay Matthews, taking on the one, Owen Travers. And in your main event for the Pro Wrestling All-Stars Heavyweight Championship, you have the challenger from the Wrestler of the Movie, the Necro Butcher, taking on the current champion, Officer Rod Street. And as an added special stipulation, members of the State of Corruption will be handcuffed to each post outside the ring, which is a barn burner match. and then we had the special attraction of the giant Cucamonga and more. Fans, Melvindale, Michigan, the Play Atlantis. The address is 19400 Allen Road in Melvindale, Michigan, 48122. You get it? You got it? Are we good?
We're good.
We're good. All right. You figure it out. Thanks for having me.
All right, man. All right. Thanks.
All right, come on.
All right, there you go. There's Steven Riviera. Oh, boy. And I think I'm going to take a commercial break, and I think this song basically fits exactly what's going on for the last hour. So we'll be back in four. You're listening to Shoot the Ropes on the Amped Radio. I'll hear from you in four.
Hey, Mongoloids, listen up. This is Robert A. Tucker. I've got a thing to say to all of you. You need to listen in to myself and Brandon, the Big Ticket Able, every Tuesday from 8 to 10 p.m. Eastern, right here on Amped Radio. Our show is called Chatting with the Elite. We talk about politics, we talk about pop culture, we talk about whatever the hell we want. And guess what? If you don't listen in, there's going to be hell to pay, and the Elite coming after you, baby.
Ah, there you go. The call number is 1-859-652-3922. Of course, we just spoke for the last hour with Steven Riviera, promoter of PWAS, which is Pro Wrestling All-Stars. Obviously, he had a lot to say. Put me on the spot, put him on the spot. That's exactly what this show is. Like I said, this show is not candy-coated. This show is a shoot. There is no script. There is no format. There is no nothing on this show. Nothing but raw talk, raw emotion, and everything else. So you never obviously know what you can expect on this show. Never know. You know, you can call in, go after me, I can go after you. You know, that's what happens on this show. And obviously, I'm trying to make my own brand of wrestling radio talk. Just like I did back a decade ago. Obviously, difference is there's no FCC, there's no no barrier, no fourth wall, as they would say, in the wrestling business. So anything goes, and that's exactly what the show's all about. Now, one of the things that's come up in the last couple days, the WWE, obviously, today they announced that WrestleMania 32 will be held in Arlington, Texas. In Jerry Jones's stadium, and it looks like he's going to try to break the WrestleMania 3 attendance record of 92,000, which this building obviously holds more than 100,000. People have been, ever since the stadium got built, they've been waiting for WrestleMania to get there. They finally made the announcement this afternoon in Texas, as, of course, last night they had their Raw show in Dallas. I think it was in Dallas. It was in Texas either way. So they made the announcement for WrestleMania April 3rd, 2016. So it'll be WrestleMania 32, and we'll see who actually gets to hold the title and what will be going on for that show. But like I said, WWE, it came out this afternoon that former WWE talents Vito Grasso, who was known in WCW and WWE just for a little bit, Big Vito and Evan Singleton, known as Adam Rooster in developmental, that filed a class action concussion lawsuit against WWE in Pennsylvania. The lawsuit seeks unspecified economic damages and medical monitoring. They're being represented by the same lawyer who was hired by former WWE star Billy Jack Haynes in his lawsuit against the company. The WWE lawyer Jerry McDevitt issued the following statement in response to the lawsuit this evening, stating, quote unquote, "This lawsuit is virtually identical to one filed by the same lawyers in Oregon, neither of which have any merit. The WWE has never concealed any medical information related to concussions or otherwise from our talent. WWE was well aware of sports organizations in implementing concussion management procedures and policies as a precautionary measure as the science and research on this issue emerged. We'll vigorously contest this lawsuit." Of course, the NFL has had lawsuits concerning the concussions, and they brought up many many points that Big Vito and Adam Mercer, as they were known, stating of over the course of the last 10 years, a lot of the wrestlers have committed suicide and had, of course, they bring up the Chris Benoit issue. having to do with the brain damage, and what they said was, I don't have it on me, but they were talking about the condition, I think it was CRT or CTR, in their brain, and obviously this is going to be a story to watch. I think in a way it was kind of poor taste that these guys announced this right around when they went to announce WrestleMania 32. I think it was more of a staged thing by these guys. I'm not going to say that they're wrong in it. Obviously, Vito did a lot more work in WCW and outside, especially with ECW as well, and a Mercer developmental wrestler. Don't really know who he is, and it's probably because I didn't really follow the developmental, unless it had something to do with the guys here locally in Michigan or whatnot, or someone that was a big name in independence, going to the WWE, WWF, whatever you want to call them. So this will be something that everyone's going to want to watch. And what's kind of funny is that that they had this announcement, we had the WrestleMania 32 announcement, and then the stock for some reason went down to not $9.99 like the WWE Network. It went down to $9.98 and went up to $10. So, of course, a lot of people are actually jumping on their stock, I guess, because I guess it was the lowest for a while. Now, TNA had their first actual episode of TNA Impact on Destination America this past Friday, which drew 387,000 viewers. That was the first episode, obviously, for the Friday night time slot. It was up from 359,000 viewers that Impact drew on Wednesday, January 7th, which was the Destination America premiere. And I will tell you this, I'm not a TNA fan. I was actually watched that first episode of TNA Impact. I was impressed. They had a stellar show. Then, of course, when you actually look at their crowds, and me and Steve were actually speaking about this earlier, was that the crowds, obviously they had the TV taping, which drew about like 1,000. It was like 750 people. And then they had like 1,000. Then the quote-unquote house show only drew about 400. So it kind of just goes to show everyone's basically only going there for the TV, and if TNA can't even sell out, even small arenas, it's obviously an issue, for TNA, even if they have the Destination America. I surprisingly have the channel. I didn't know if I did. and especially with their move the Friday night, I don't know how well of a planned move that was. I think that was something that they did. They planned ahead, and then, of course, the WWE decided, well, we're going to move our show to back to Thursdays, our original date, and now TNA doesn't have anyone to go head-to-head against wrestling-wise. So that is the question, is how will this actually help TNA? TNA, with Destination America, as from going from Spike TV, I really... Like I said, I don't really watch TNA. I really don't know how this is going to help them or how it's going to hurt them. Now there's, of course, the rumors that former TNA wrestlers, the Dudley Boys, may show up at the pay-per-view this Sunday, Royal Rumble. And it's kind of funny that they switch to their networks. They go to a new network. And a lot of their stars from TNA that the wrestling community, the fans that are looking for wrestling would recognize are no longer on that program. Obviously, they've got the Hardys, you know, old wrestling fans, WWF and whatnot. You've got Kurt Angle. And then it just goes from there. Sting and Hogan obviously had been part of TNA, and they were supposed to bring in the ratings. Hogan was a complete flop. Eric Bischoff was a complete flop. Sting was kind of there, you know, of course. Then you had they tried to do the whole ECW thing in there, and that really didn't help TNA. And I kind of felt bad for TNA because they were trying to show that they were the number two company. And to me, to be honest, I think that the number two company, even though they don't have TV in my area, is Ring of Honor. Ring of Honor has really showcased itself. I know Ring of Honor is supposed to be having a show here in Dearborn soon as well in Michigan. And it's actually one of the promotions that a lot of the guys have popped up, obviously from on the WWE, and fans are excited to see these guys in a new spotlight, either TNA or WWE. The only thing is that a lot of people are afraid and fear that with them going to WWE, they will completely retransform their character and the type of wrestler that they've always been, that the people that the fans have loved. You know, everyone's been kind of afraid with Stein, exactly what they're going to do with him in the WWE. And obviously, I mean, I don't watch NXT either, which, you know, I really shouldn't even be talking about because I don't even watch it. But there's always that concern as to how the independent guys are going to get transformed from to work in the WWE mold. And that's always been the precursor for if someone's career is gonna falter or whatnot. I know everyone was talking about the ascension coming from NXT to WWE, and look what's happened now. Obviously, now they got a pay-per-view match against the New Age Outlaws, which I guess the ascension is going to be the Legend Killers of the tag team division, I guess. So watch them end up taking out the New Age Outlaws this Sunday on pay-per-view. Of course, we got the match for Royal Rumble. We've got the heavyweight title match. It's a head scratcher right now. I know Brock Lesnar's going to lose it. I don't know if they're going to give John Cena the record 16th title, or if they're going to give it to Seth. I really don't see them giving it to Seth. I could see for some, you know, obviously either they could give it to Brock and then Brock would lose next night to somebody else, or John Cena. It really confuses me as to what they're going to do with that because they have Brock set to go at WrestleMania. So I am kind of wondering if maybe Brock Lesnar's going to win the title and hold on to it till WrestleMania, and John Cena will just be out of the picture for a while, and we won't see Cena and Lesnar. We'll see Lesnar and somebody else for the title. Seth Rollins obviously is going to have a program with John Cena for a while, so I think it's going to be John Cena and Rollins going back and forth again. So we're just going to see exactly what WWE does. Of course, just we got about a minute or two here to go. Let me go back over that show real quick. Obviously, we had Mr. Rivera on. I don't even know why I said Mr. Rivera. That was bad. But they are going, like I said, they're having their show January 23rd, this Friday at 7 p.m. at the Play Atlantis in Melvindale, Michigan. The address is 19400 Allen Road, Melvindale, Michigan. Let's see, doors open at 7, shows start at 7:30, tickets just $10 for adults, $5 for kids under 12, tickets are only available at the door on a first-come, first-served basis. The main events for the PWAS Heavyweight Championship, Officer Rod Street defends his title against the Necro Butcher with special stipulations that each member of the State of Corruption will be handcuffed to each ring post. Plus Chase Matthews defends his PWAS Cruiser Corps Championship against the rival, the one, Owen Travers, in a special last man standing match. Also newly crowned PWAS Tag Team Champions, the threat of Amazing Nate Madsen and the King of Status, Bart Wellington, make their first tag team title defense against former PWAS Tag Team Champions, the High Stars of the Natural Lance Star at Atlas Hightower. Plus the Wrestle Bowl Gauntlet match, where the winner gets a future PWAS title shot, and the PWAS debut of the tallest wrestler of the United States in independent wrestling scene, the giant Cucamonga, makes his first Michigan indie wrestling appearance at Wrestle Bowl. More information coming soon. You can find them on Facebook at Pro Wrestling All Stars. And, you know, obviously you can go on there on Facebook and you can find them. And, other than that, I can't think of anything else. I want to thank everyone for listening here to Shooting the Ropes on Amped Radio. You can look for us on iTunes. You can also look for us on YouTube as well for the archives. Don't forget we've had Dave Drazon on. We've had Rudy Hill from JCW, which they're having a show at the Crowfoot this weekend as well. We've had the DBA. We had last week we had TNA champion Chris Sabin. We've had Austin Mannix. Chuck Wagon was here in the studio. I mean, we've had a pretty good 2015 since the show's been back on the air in December of this year. I want to thank everyone for listening. You know, it might be good if I actually pulled some type of music to kind of end this show out with. So I want to thank everyone for listening. Amped Radio, you've got the Chasing the Elite. Chatting with the Elite, which is tomorrow night, 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time here on Amped Radio. And until next Tuesday, I see toodaloo, folks.